Welcome to the EMBL webinar series on lifelong learning in the biomedical sciences. My name is Claire Johnson. I work in the training team at EMBL's European Bioinformatics Institute in Cambridge, and I'm on the programme committee for this webinar series. So today I am pleased to welcome three speakers, Claire Skentelbery, Izabel Alfany and Rachel Simpson, co-presenting on the topic of building a scientific career beyond the bench. Claire, Rachel and Izabel will each describe their career journeys as part of their presentations. So rather than present their biographies now, let me give you their current job titles and affiliations. Claire Skentelbery is Director General of Nanotechnology Industries Association in Belgium. Rachel Simpson is a Technology Transfer Manager for the University Technology Transfer Office at the University of Dundee in the UK. And Izabel Alfany is a Business Development Manager leading health strategic projects at LEITAT Technological Centre near Barcelona in Spain. So the way this webinar will work, we'll have presentations from Claire, Izabel and Rachel, and then they will all give their tips and advice, and then we will do a joint question and answer session at the end. Okay, so if I could then hand over to Claire.
Thanks very much indeed, another Claire. So it was very kind to be invited to take part in this webinar today, and I hope that we can be useful for you. We've pulled together three relatively useful human beings who no longer work at the bench within science and have fairly diverse career pathways. So hopefully give you some kind of idea about how you could look at developing your own career away from the bench. So I will start with a quick overview in that what I have certainly observed in my career is that it's very difficult to understand what is out there for scientists working at the bench. There's often a lack of awareness of different opportunities, particularly if you've come very strongly up through a university system only, where your researchers and teachers will also have probably only worked within a university environment. However, very few people with a PhD actually stay at the bench as part of their career, but it's still often considered the primary pathway to have if you are even considering a PhD. However, there are a lot of reasons to take a PhD, staying at the bench being only one of them. It really does help you develop very significant skills that can be used in a lot of different applications after your PhD or postdoc. And really the message I would try to have people take away from the webinar today is that a job away from the bench is not a secondary option. It's often a superb primary option for many people with a PhD. It really develops skills in lots of different applications and allows you to grow upon them in a variety of different jobs. And when we talk about the variety of jobs, it's absolutely enormous. And I think there is no particular standard career path and hasn't been for a very long time. So there is no job for life within industry of any shape or size. And indeed, in many times, there is no job for life within a university either. The variety of jobs is very broad, the countries in which you can apply them is very broad, and the types of organisations in which you can take a scientific PhD are very broad indeed. So hopefully we will give you a small introduction to that today and help answer any questions at the end. So the aim and structure of this webinar, as Claire has already explained, is to just look at the opportunities there are away from the bench and how you de-risk your selection process and decide your routes forward. The content, as I've said, are two really excellent people who I have met in my career, and they have very strong career pathways that have taken them away from the bench as well. We are going to briefly describe what our career treks have been and learn what the triggers were and why we decided to do what we did. And at the end, we'll present some tips and answer as many questions as we can fit into the webinar. So this is me. Although you'll be pleased to know I actually don't look like that photograph anymore, which is fine. So I'll give you a really quick overview of how I got to the ripe old age of 45 in the job that I have at the moment. I started off with a degree in agriculture, which was extremely interesting and diverse, and followed that up with a PhD in crop biochemistry. And I was very fortunate to have that sponsored by an agrochemical company, which gave me a placement during my PhD. I then moved out away from the bench immediately after my PhD and went and worked in a scientific marketing agency, which within the healthcare biotech sector, which was extremely interesting. And that was, I call that a real job because I was actually an employee for that job, as I was for my next one, when I became the national contact point for Framework Program 5, where I advised small to medium enterprises about how they could access EU funds and put together strong collaborations and strong proposals. So that was substantially different from my marketing agency work, but used many of the same skills, such as the ability to plan and draft very clear and coherent research proposals. I used that to actually become an independent consultant, and I spent some very happy years writing proposals and other technical writing for scientific companies. I did a lot of other jobs alongside that. So I ran conferences, I undertook scientific promotion, and I also got involved in cluster development, which really strongly shaped my career path after that. While I was working as an independent consultant, primarily within the biotech cluster in Cambridge, I became part of the founding team behind a network called the Council of European Bioregions, which was a network of biotech clusters across Europe. And I became manager of that as I had been involved in managing the project that developed it. It became logical to move from the UK to Belgium into Brussels, which for me is the center of the world, of course, and was much easier to run an EU-wide network from. From CIBA, I then became Secretary General of the European Biotechnology Network, which was a cross-sectoral network, which is much more scientifically focused, but worked across all different types of organisations. So a really nice opportunity to work with universities and industry at the same time. And that led me to my current role, which is Director General of the Nanotechnology Industries Association, which is built on all of my previous roles. And now I still am based within Brussels and work to support the development of commercial nanotechnology all over the world. And when I'm not doing that, I am an EC expert reviewer, which can be reviewing proposals or reviewing projects as they progress from Horizon 2020 funding. So really, what triggered me to move away from the bench? I mean, I really, really enjoyed my PhD, and I would have, you know, it would have been quite obvious to try and stay within that sector if I hadn't learned about anything else. But I had really already started working quite diversely through my degree, which covered science, economics, and policy making around the delivery of agriculture. So I already had a good understanding of the other non-scientific factors which impact the development of products and the development of sectors. I was extremely fortunate to have my PhD sponsored by a company. So during that time, I spent 6 weeks on placement in that company and saw a lot of more of the decision-making processes that companies made. And I found that really interesting. And I think the big thing that helped me decide there were a lot more opportunities outside the bench for me was going on a residential course during my PhD, which was actually run by a lot of different large companies. And they put you in lots of different scenarios where you had to make decisions and use your PhD skills to talk about problems as diverse as, you know, running town councils through to, you know, managing international crises. So it was a very good opportunity to look at how you use your skills in different ways. And finally, really, as I progressed through my PhD, I wanted to be really good at it. And I realized I was not the best scientist in the world. And I always make the terrible joke that I realized I was only going to set the world on fire as a scientist if I literally set it on fire. So towards the end of my PhD, I decided that I would look for job opportunities away from the bench. And for that, I really had to understand what I knew how to do well and had the ability to grow more. And so scientific writing and communication was a backbone of everything that I have done, and I really enjoyed doing it. So that allowed me to look for jobs that would allow me to grow and develop that. I've always enjoyed working across different sectors and across different organization types, which my degree in particular helped me to do. And the key thing I found to do there was people appreciate it very much if you make it easy for them to understand something from a different sector or a different type of organisation. So essentially, I've grown through my career as I suppose what you would call a fixer. And you help people understand what influences the application of their science. So not just the brilliance of the science, but the economic and political impacts that are going to alter whether that progresses successfully or not. And in developing up my skills through particularly working as the national contact point, it was always about understanding how to present a balanced and strong interaction between lots of different sciences and lots of different organisation types. It is not about putting your own work first. And in fact, that was the downfall of many collaborative research programmes when they were so clearly dominated by one type of work or one type of organisation. And I was very happy to become an independent person. So I stopped being an employee and essentially set up my own company through which I could run a diverse number of jobs. Essentially, I was a consultant. So I knew, and having come from a family where many people were self-employed, I understood that you needed to be proactive and you always need to be looking for work. And I was happy to do that. And I wasn't afraid to take risks or make changes, because as we go through sector maturation, you realize that there, as I said before, there is no job for life in particular. And so whether you work at a university or a large company, that could alter without you having any control over it. So I was very happy to take the risk to become independent and try and build my own career pathway. And the final thing was, I realized in job hunting, and looking back at the jobs that I have had, I never had a job that I knew actually existed. They're all really strange. And so there are very few jobs that you can actually predict. And even if I could predict a job now, the odds are that in 5 years' time, that job will not exist and a completely new set of jobs will be available. So I wanted to leave my short presentation with a few examples of jobs that I went and researched just this week on LinkedIn, which for me is a very, very useful platform to use when looking for jobs away from traditional research. And you can see in front of you a very long list of different types of jobs, none of which involve you working directly at a bench, but all of which involve your planning and delivery capability and your ability to work and understand science. Doesn't have to be the science that you trained in, but a PhD allows you to understand a lot of different sciences. And the types of organisations that offer jobs for people who are scientifically qualified is extremely broad. Whether you're working specifically within a scientific focus or not, your skills and capabilities and ability to understand much broader information is in high demand in a lot of different organisations. So that wraps up my short section. So if I ask Claire to change the slides again, I will hand over to Rachel Simpson, who will talk you through her career track and pathway forward. Thanks very much, Rachel.
Thanks, Claire. So my name is Rachel Simpson. I have the same starting point as Claire in that we both did the same degree in agriculture. I went on to do a PhD in molecular genetics, and then following that, it was an industrially funded PhD. Then I went into industry and I ended up doing 5 years as a postdoctoral researcher within industry in two separate places, and this was in molecular genetics again. So my career progression after that point was due to being a little frustrated at the options of getting into management. So as a postdoc in industry, I was running very small teams, and I wanted to move up into a more managerial rather than being at the bench. But due to the financial insecurities in the industry I was in at the time, the options to do that were really limited. So for a brief period of time, I was looking around and seeing how could I use the knowledge and experience that I had in a different way. And so I took a short period of time working as a clinical scientist in a hospital, because there was a clinical scientist role that was available that also would make use of my molecular genetics skills. And I did that for 9 months, but at the same time, I consulted back to continuing to provide assistance to the company that I had worked at as a scientist. And as a result of that, I realised that I needed to move away from the bench completely because I was just not going to get any career progression there. I was interested in law. I had several friends who were lawyers, and I was interested in understanding more about that. So in the UK, you can learn how to become a lawyer by going to university on a short course. So this is a very condensed course that takes a year. And after that, you have to do a practice course as well if you want to go into becoming a qualified lawyer. I was very lucky to do some work placements at solicitors firms in the UK. And as a result of that, I was offered a traineeship place with a firm in Cambridge. And I undertook 2 years of training there, where I was paid as a trainee. After I qualified, I worked as a solicitor for 2 years, working in something quite different to my scientific training. So I worked as a property litigator. And then I saw that a role came up at the place where I had done my PhD, where they were wanting a contracts manager. And I thought it would be a great opportunity to combine my scientific understanding with my legal training. And so I went back to join the research institute where I did my PhD as a contracts manager. So over 8 years, I was a contracts manager in a research setting. So first at an institute and then at the University of Dundee. And I focused primarily on business transactions, but also general research transactions. And so as a result of that, I was recruited into a technology transfer role, which is very much focused on the life sciences, which again makes use of my scientific experience, which is getting quite old now, but it also just means that I can understand science and try and find deals for the science. And in order to do that, I need to understand the science to a certain level and understand how it could be used with industry, whether that's selling it to industry or getting it into a collaborative research organization to take it forward. So in terms of looking at the career path, my career path sort of looks like it was organized, but it only looks organized in hindsight. So what key skills did I have as a scientist that were transferable to change field? And I would say that the one thing that all scientists are is analytical. We have a really good skill of looking at complex data and finding the headline from it. So at a very basic level, in order to do an assay at a bench, you'll need to look at published literature, understand it, compare it, and then use it in a way, and also modify it as new information comes out. All of these analytical skills are really transferable to very many different types of career roles, like the ones that Claire was talking about at the end of her presentation. The other thing that you'll be very good at is that as a scientist, you'll have really clear writing skills. So in my job, I need to write contracts that have unambiguous drafting, and I try my best to do that. But if you're a scientist, you'll be reviewing papers, you'll need to write your lab notebooks in a clear and understandable way. And if you're writing funding applications, you also need to write in a way that's clearly understood by someone who doesn't know your field. So this is another really good transferable skill, is the ability to write clearly. The other thing that scientists are generally and hopefully organized have as a skill is that they're very organized. So the ability to plan and organize your day, because at the bench you need to make sure that you've given enough time for certain things to happen, to plan working with others, to plan competing priorities, and to work to different deadlines. You'll also be really good at team working, hopefully, in that you need to work with a wide variety of people and with a wide variety of skill sets. So if you need to go out and find expertise to help you with your laboratory experiments, you need to be able to identify that and also work with them to get something that you need. This, is a transferable skill. Being research aware is generally something that is definitely a transferable skill for working in technology transfer. And that's not just the science, because the science moves at such a pace that you can't possibly know what it's going to do at the coalface. So it's more of a general understanding about how university research operates, that scientists have a need to publish, how funding is obtained, and what are the competing priorities in the research environment. So the bottom line is that the scientific knowledge, as you go on in different careers, the scientific knowledge itself is not a fundamental requirement in my role because the field changes so quickly, but just understanding how scientists operate and what motivates them can really help me do my job. And that comes from having a scientific background. So I think next I'm going to transfer to Izabel Alfany.
Hi everyone. Thank you. Thank you for the invitation. I hope that my short speech also help you anyhow to find a way, you know, and the best one for you in your careers. So trying not to be so repetitive, because I'm totally aligned with the great speech from Claire and also from Rachel. So it's I'll try to highlight some point out some spots that I think could be complementary to them. So let's going through my career. I'm Brazilian, half Spanish. So I started my bachelor in biological sciences there in Brazil. And I was eager to try an international experience to my career. So then I decided Spanish, counting on my also half nationality, to try on how to go on with this career in biological science. And coming from the university, I was really connected to research. I did some preliminary traineeships there, and I really enjoy to be on the bench in this phase of my career. So my focus at this time, it was indeed going further in the career, doing the master and the PhD here. When I come, I was accepted in the University of Barcelona, Spain. So once I started that, I think I have the experience of passing through many phases in the research, you know, from the planning the experimental assays, writing also the papers that I finally are publishing, together with our directors of PhD, of course. But I think I have a global overview on research. But what I felt, it was a clear difficulty for going further in the researcher career, because here in Spain and of course in many other countries, we have lack of fundings for the researchers. So it's quite difficult to get a position. It's necessary to go abroad again to improve your knowledge and being with the top 10 research groups worldwide. So it was necessary indeed to go further and abroad for this career. I wasn't keen to move again from Barcelona. I was really comfortable here. And I also assumed that the passion that I have from research wasn't indeed linked to the bench, but for the global, I think, the global idea of research. So once I ended my PhD, I started to look around to see what was happening. And at this stage, several years ago, many of the positions that we have now wasn't there yet, or it was quite limited. So I tried some interviews to different opportunities. As an example, one process of interview I got into, it was for a marketing agency for pharmaceutical companies. So we are doing all the writings for the pharmaceutical, focusing the marketing. It was done by researchers. Another one was, well, closer to the former fields. It was a cosmetic industry. So it would be like a project manager position for me, for taking over a group of researchers within the cosmetic industry. And this was quite similar for the previous activities. And the third one was the international project manager position at LEITAT here, that was requesting knowledge in the field of health and also knowledge in the in funding schemes for European projects and so on, other opportunities. I applied for it. I did have the, of course, the knowledge in the health sector from the PhD, not more than this, but it was, I think, I guess, sufficient to cover the needs here. And I didn't have any experience in EU projects. Nonetheless, I think in the balance, it counted my previous experience, and I started this this challenge here at LEITAT that I'm still here. So this position was trying to find opportunities for the researchers that we have here in the technological center, and linking the opportunities to other funding opportunities, collaboration opportunities with other organizations, and also to building up projects proposal, let's say, before funding, for applying for it, and getting the funding for them. So it's a broad activity, and the thing is that with the knowledge of the researcher phase, the researching phase that we have previously by the PhD traineeship, this help always helped me to support specifically the researchers here. They need, I think, for the projects in general, for collaborative projects funded by European Commission, for instance, they require a good scientific coordinator, but a good coordinator that could manage all the projects with a global overview. And we, with this career tracking, it's feasible to do it. So after some years in this position, I was also appointed as independent expert for the European Commission, just like similar to the Claire's position that she mentioned before. So this was an invitation, as it was in recognition of the good results that we have here for the projects that we submitted from LEITAT. They were high scored, so they contacted me as coordinator from the projects, leader from the projects, to also be an independent expert. So we are taking part in the panel of experts for the evaluation of the projects. Okay, and finally, I assumed the position on business development manager here at LEITAT. So I'm not involved anymore in the execution of the bids and of the projects, but only from the business development indeed. So until the submission of the proposals, I'm working hard to connecting and to getting more funds and more collaborations for the technological center here in Barcelona. In parallel to this career track, it's important to farm the curiosity and not stop doing improvements in your educations. So I'd like to highlight that I was keeping doing courses while I was getting experience at LEITAT. So I did a project management course applied to the framework program 7. I did also a B2B sales course in house here in our facilities, negotiation strategies course. And now I'm doing the Master in Business Innovation. I think that's quite important, but this is also natural from our characteristics, the curiosity that we take from the researchers, spirit that we have. It's normal that we are keeping the track and doing these such courses, and it's important for any type of career. Just entering in the session from tips, and afterwards I'll be forwarded by our colleagues here. Indeed, as I mentioned before, we should farm the scientist curiosity always. So we keep studying, we keep the track of the innovation field is always changing, so it's a must to be doing courses and getting information around, all around. This is something that we researchers, we do really, really, really good. Know your strengths, just like Rachel highlighted, the strengths that we carry from the PhD that we did are really unique. So we have to recognize them and sell it properly for the next position that we are applying for. Research about all the options and all the options around, just the ones mentioned by Claire, the list that she did as only an example, but there are much more information around. So go through LinkedIn, go through all the channels that you can find opportunities and suggestions on where are the positions focused to, finally. And yeah, new positions are coming up. The positions that we will have in the next 5 years from now, several of them, and maybe the majority, are not yet identified, or is not, or they are maybe limited just now. Just what happened with me with the position of expert in Horizon 2020 European projects. Here at the time that I began, it was really a differential position, and now there are plenty of opportunities in this field. And the last one that I want to mention before passing the word is signing up for positions in order to practice during interviews. You will learn from each interview you go through, so it's important to have this practice. Even though you are not so interested in the position, it's important to go and to practice. Go and try. Go and try to sell yourself and improve more each session. I think it's important for us here. So maybe I'm finishing here, just passing the word to, I think, Claire, to keeping on the tips. So
thanks very much, Izabel. So this is just a small summary of things to think about. It's like when I've developed my career, is really, what do you actually like doing? Not necessarily the topic, but the way you like to work. And what kind of environment do you enjoy working in? Some people really like to work within a very structured and well-ordered environment, or others will enjoy sort of unpredictability and things that may change that are not immediately within their control. And examples of that are, if you quite like taking on lots of new challenges, looking for work in smaller companies is always a really good idea, because whatever you put in makes a huge difference to the course of that company. And I would always say, take all opportunities. Don't be too prescriptive about what you think you would like to do, because you don't know what kind of skills you're going to get in different job opportunities. And you will find yourself challenged by things, and you will find out what you like and what you don't like. So it's that applies to not only looking at new jobs, but within your existing jobs, take on additional roles to stretch yourself and to find what you enjoy doing and how you enjoy working. So if you have the opportunity to be on committees that can organise events, undertake some writing, help somebody set up a website, write a newsletter, get involved where you have to manage people, or you have to develop processes for something within your department. These are all really good skills that having them will start to put you ahead of other people that have not done that. And I think what you will take from all of our presentations is that you can really forget a smooth career path. Those kind of things don't really exist anymore. And as I found, if you change focus, you may have to start with a lower salary to build the experience in that new sector. So when I finished my PhD and applied for jobs within scientific marketing, I applied for graduate level jobs, because although I had a PhD, I had no experience within scientific marketing. And so that's always a thing that you should take into account. And just as Izabel and Rachel have said, you need to be relaxed about what jobs are out there for you. It is extremely difficult to predict what jobs exist even now, let alone the ones that are going to be there in 5 years' time. And read job offers everywhere. Don't just stick to the back of magazines or websites that you already read. So for me, LinkedIn is an incredibly valuable tool. So I would get yourself signed up on that and start looking at groups you can join. And then you will start to see job descriptions that will help you understand the different sectors, different job types that are out there. and do things that are outside your current comfort zone. So if you work within a very academic environment right now, start going to industry conferences to understand how people present their science and themselves and what their priorities are. It's a really good idea to see how different types of people and organizations operate. And also looking at it from a policy perspective, find some interesting events within your scientific area within Brussels and look at the surrounding work that goes on there, you know, building research infrastructure, planning future funding programs, getting policy initiatives to work together. These are all highly relevant for your area of interest as well. So that's my set of tips. So I'll finally pass on to Rachel to give her words of wisdom.
Thank you, Claire. So I think just to sum up very quickly, I think what we're all talking about here is trying to identify your transferable skills. At a very fundamental level, all scientists are problem solvers. And the world absolutely has a massive need for problem solvers. So try and think about what really motivates you. As Claire was saying, what do you enjoy doing? Can you write clearly? Do you present complex ideas very clearly? Do you enjoy training people? Do you enjoy meeting new people and traveling? Focus on what you enjoy doing, because in my role, I enjoy writing creatively to solve problems, and this is reflected in the type of contract negotiations that I get involved in. And it really is all about your transferable skills. And this, if you think about those, then pretty much the world is your oyster.
Thank you. Thank you all very much. We're going to go over to questions now. So questions. We have had some questions that were submitted as people registered. So we're going to start with those, and we'll get through as many as we can and hopefully go to some of the questions that you're submitting now as well, time permitting. Okay, so first question, and this will be to Rachel. How do you go about figuring out what you do beyond the bench, and how do you align your skills with that?
So I would start really simply. And so in the research organisation where you currently are, look around the other colleagues that aren't working at the bench. So if you come into contact with your press office, for instance, or people working in finance, are you interested in their role? Talk to people that you work with that are in different areas that don't work at the bench anymore. You'll find that a surprising number of them could have come from research if you talk to them. Talk to them about how they got to where they are, and can they help you get advice in terms of what other options are open to you. So really, it's a very simple way to start, which is to start talking to other people that aren't working at the bench that you come into contact with regularly.
Okay, thank you. So I've grouped some of these questions as well. So the next two, which are related, are for Izabel. What does it take to make a move outside academia? Is a postdoc necessary after a PhD if one wants to leave academia and join industry?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, the first one, just the way it is, it seems like you are going, as we hear around, going to the black side, no, of the world once we are leaving academia. No, it's not something great to move outside academia. It's just another step, just like Claire highlighted. It's not a secondary movement. No, it's another option. Not going further in the research area, but going to industry or other position. So it's in the same way that we mentioned before. I think is the first step is knowing your skills, knowing and knowing how to sell them. If we need a postdoc for going to industry, not always, not necessarily, and you are also capable to apply for industry, not for a researcher position. So if you're not going for a researcher position, is in even less you need the postdoc. It depends on every position you are looking for. As much as you have as education levels, it's better for you, but it's not a must depending on which position you are applying to.
Thank you. The next set of three questions I'm going to ask Claire to answer. So that how do you build a CV that leverages my research expertise for a non-research driven company? What should a PhD graduate do after graduation, not to sit idle while looking for jobs? And how do you get that first experience at the post beyond the bench if everyone is looking for somebody who already has experience?
Okay, so to answer the first one, building your CV, I would very much, as well as obviously having your scientific capability, you need to expand your description of tasks that through which you've used your science. You know, have you done event management? What are your communication skills? What additional experiences do you have that show them how good you are applying your ability for critical thinking? So it should really be about work that you have undertaken beyond your work directly at the bench. So I would definitely look at that. And that is a reason why you would go and take on additional roles while you are studying for your PhD or working as a postdoc. So you have demonstrations of your work outside science. In terms of what should a PhD graduate do whilst looking for jobs, the first thing I would say is you should be applying for jobs a long time before you graduate. You should be applying for jobs while you are finishing writing your PhD, because it can often take quite a long time to get a job. So you need to start as early as possible. And while you are still job hunting, I would look for internships. If you're not going to get paid to do something, you might as well get not paid whilst doing something useful. So there are many internships available at national and European level. And that if you can afford to do that, some pay and some do not pay, you should be able to start building up that first critical experience. And it shows that you are interested in looking at lots of different sectors. So for example, in Brussels, almost all of the hundreds and hundreds of associations here will have internships. And so you can go and get interesting job experience across a huge number of sectors. So I would strongly recommend that. How to get that first experience beyond the bench if everybody is looking for somebody with experience? You have to pitch yourself where they will take somebody without experience in that sector. And that is why I applied for jobs at the graduate level. My PhD, whilst incredibly valuable, did not automatically boost me higher up the job search ladder compared to people that didn't have a PhD necessarily. So definitely pitch yourself at the level at which you will get in. So I think that should be cover those three questions.
Okay, thank you. The next question to Izabel. With an educational background in biomedicine, did you feel the need to take a course on business development?
Yes, indeed. I mentioned that I took some small courses, and now I'm candidate for a master of in business innovation. I think for me it has been really useful to have the right methodologies to indeed figure out the economic impact of everything that is being developed here as innovation potential in researchers. So I think for me it was really important to take this training in business coming from science. For me it's really useful to focus and learn about the methodologies that they use in the business world.
Thank you. And the next question to Claire. What is the future scope of translational nanomedicine when it is transferred from bench to bedside?
Okay, that's pretty specific. But I can say the future scope is potentially very high, but it's still very early. There is not much in nano that has been transferred directly into the clinic, and less still that has made it through regulatory approval and into patients as products.
Okay, and I guess kind of similar in the clinical area. The next couple of questions to Rachel. Do you have any advice for PhD graduates who would like to move to the clinical area? And can you please emphasize on the scope in clinical research and moving to pharmaceutical companies after doctoral studies?
Yeah, so my background was in molecular genetics from a non-clinical research area. But I ended up working as a clinical scientist in a hospital setting. And the reason that I got that role is because the skills that I had in molecular genetics were incredibly applicable to the role as a clinical scientist. So I think if you're not already working in clinical science as a PhD student, then again, it's looking at your transferable skills. What analytical skills do you have that match a clinical role that's available? I suppose in the UK, the difference there is that roles will need to be advertised and approved beforehand. So they will need to stick to a rigid job description. So you need to read the job description, but also think about not the specifics of the clinical research itself, but do you have any of the skills that they need that are set out in the job description? In terms of moving to pharmaceutical companies after doctoral studies, again, if you're not in a clinical research setting, then again, it's looking at your transferable skills and what can you offer to a pharmaceutical company that they might not already have. Pharmaceutical companies, certainly the ones that I deal with regularly, always have a requirement for a good biologist and good chemists and people who can manage large amounts of data. So if you're in bioinformatics or statistics and you're doing that as part of your bench research, then this is going to be really applicable to a pharmaceutical company. So again, it's looking at jobs that are advertised and roles that are advertised and trying to think about how your experience might fit with it, even if strictly looking at it doesn't look like there is a good fit. It might be that you have the right skills to apply. And as Claire said in her presentation, it's applying for roles because you'll learn so much from being interviewed that is really valuable. So if you think that you have a decent overlap with a pharmaceutical company role, talk to them, apply for it, and if you get interviewed, then you'll learn so much from that. Thank you.
Okay, next question to Claire. I'm interested in knowing about working science politics. Could you tell us about working at the European level on this?
Sure. I mean, there's a lot of different ways in which science is applied inside European policy development. A lot of people will take a master's course that looks at policy development or public affairs to help them to understand the structures of policy decision making, and that is probably applicable across lots of different sectors. It doesn't just have to be about science, but again, a good way to go and do that is to get involved in an internship in an association, particularly as a science association within Brussels, because you should learn about how Brussels works, the decision making and the development pathway of policy areas. And that also stands you in good. That also works exactly the same at a national level as well, because you will have science policy development at national level. And also when you look at, say, large charities or funding bodies, they will also be looking at science policy. So I would focus looking at science policy jobs at national and charity and funding level, plus looking at, if you were really interested in it, perhaps taking a one-year master's degree that would prepare you better for changing the direction of your work.
Thank you. So the last couple of questions I'm going to throw out to be answered by any of the three of you. So what are the main skills that teachers have to foster in 21st century students? And how can we improve the awareness about non-clinical scientific careers among high school students? And that's kind of especially in developing countries.
Well, I'm happy to take that first if you would like. I would always just say it's looking at science in application. So it's not just teaching straight science, it's taking headlines perhaps from newspapers that talk about latest pharmaceutical developments or breakthroughs, or some kind of other scientific driven company. You know, Elon Musk is a superb example to use to look at, to understand the science that he applies into both his products that he produces and the business models that he uses, because science, of course, is not just about the science. It will only get to market or final application if it can financially afford to do so. So using real life examples of how science is delivered through to patients and rockets and things like that is a really good way to look at all of the different elements of science in action.
I would add that for teachers as well, it would Science is very network driven, and it's the people, like lots of areas, it's the people that you know that can make differences to your opportunities that you get offered. So for teachers, if they have access to people who work in different scientific using roles, to get them into the schools and to talk to their students about, very much like today, which is going through how their careers developed and how they moved from pure science into different areas like we're doing.
Wow. How can we improve the awareness about non-clinical scientific careers among high school students, specifically in developing countries? Wow. Well, I think with the it's a difficult question. I think as an example from Brazil, maybe I could start from here. The awareness we have several tools to do so. It's like aligning what my colleagues just mentioned to the previous question and applying using wireless technological tools like internet and classes, works, mocks during the classes for the high school students with the information that we have around. I think the information is to be used, and we can focus this during the sessions, the classes from high schools, and maybe it's a good way. I don't know what to say anymore about this.
Okay, thank you. I'm going to go to some questions that have been submitted at the end of the presentation. So, do you know some people that went away from the bench and then came back?
I would say
no.
No.
It's pretty much a one-way trip.
Yeah.
Another question. Do you think you would have been able to have the same career path if you didn't have your PhD? For example, if you started looking for jobs after your master's or bachelor's?
No.
Personally, I would say no.
I think at the moment that I apply for it, it wasn't yes. Maybe yeah, I could go in further, but currently for the same position, it would be impossible. And this sure happened to several other positions now. Yeah,
we've undertaken some research as well into qualification levels sought in industry, and they would take at the very least an MSc, but they would put you more towards technician level work. I think it seems to be quite to progress further. For example, if you wanted to go into business development, you still need to have a very solid scientific capability to drive business development in a scientific organization. And it seemed to be that many more doors were open if you came in with a PhD in the starting place.
Yeah, it's a plus, no, an added value, of course, always.
Okay. Thank you. Some universities are now focusing on supporting their PhD students to get jobs. Do you think this is starting to have an impact? And what additional support do the students need?
I would say from a university perspective, we are really keen on making sure that our graduates and PhD students find good roles. And so in order to facilitate that, universities do a lot of skills courses. So you can look on your university website. You might also find entrepreneurial assistance to try and get you thinking about how you might develop a business from your abilities. So I'd say that universities are really supportive of PhDs getting into jobs, because it helps the statistics to make a university look good if their PhD students go on to have a wide and varied career, because that also counts as impact for the universities.
Great, thank you. Do you think having a postdoc will have a negative impact on a job outside of academia?
No. No, I think postdoc is seen as just a further development. I think it's possible to do too many postdocs. So you can be seen as a pure bench scientist, which would make it a little harder for you to move away from the bench if you've done, I would say, three plus postdoc positions, I think it's going to get a lot harder for you to leave the bench. And that's simply because of the way that you could be viewed as being too science focused and not flexible enough. That's all I would probably
I would add to that and say, you need, if you're going to do multiple postdocs, you need to be seen to be progressing. So you can't stay at the same level. You would have to be looking at building a group, you know, progressing your own career outside your immediate bench research. If you look like you've only operated at the same level for multiple postdocs, that doesn't look so good.
Yeah, definitely.
Okay, thank you. I'm going to draw the question and answer session to a close now. And again, thank Claire, Rachel and Izabel for taking the time to share their experience, tips and advice today. And thank you everybody else for joining our webinar today. Thank you.
Thank you
for the invitation.